The video diary of a couple with AIDS.
I've lost the steam of life, the thing that powers me.
You were going through a quote unquote a period of acceptance and withdrawal and needed to be left alone so that you could get ready to die.
Silver Lake Life, the view from here. Major funding for POV has been provided by the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation. Peter Friedman, co-director.
I tried to emphasize the nature of the relationship, the way they cared for each other, the love that they shared for each other, but also their characters. I mean, Mark and Tom were characters in a sense, and they were very camera conscious, and they lived their life as though everything was a story, even in the crisis. So in a sense, that epitomizes the two different reactions that they had to their illness. Mark would stare it straight in the face and defiantly say, I'm going to beat this. I'm going to fight this as strongly as I can. I'm going to do everything possible to survive. And Tom kind of accepted his illness as a death sentence and said, well, I'm going to die, but I'm going to make a movie out of it.
The following program contains material which some viewers may find disturbing. Viewer discretion is advised.
Decided to shoot a video diary. He asked me to finish it if he couldn't.
Clear. I love you.
Here we are at Thrifty's, doing one of those tasks that just will never ever get done unless you do it. It's so tough. The simplest 5-minute task. He has to come to the car and lie down and put the seat back and rest and catch a breath. What a way to live. Huh. What a way to die.
He will work with your own cells to create a pattern of harmony and order, so all the harmony will disappear from your body. And it will be wonderful. Your body will sing. It will be like a beautiful symphony. So, Omra, we have a new friend here, Mark. Would you please come and do a nice blessing on Mark?
Oh, tiki, ta, tiki, kuka, ta, tu, ta, ta, ta. Ah, yaka, tu, ti, ta, tiki, kuka, ta, tu, ta.
Up here?
Yeah.
Has to be
there. It'll come up. About 6 years ago, and then I went in and I came out positive, and it was very shocking, to say the least. And it's always hovering in the back of your mind, and you're looking for, you know, KS spots or lesions or some sign that the disease is finally really here. I was hit with very suddenly with the streptococcus meningitis, which is kind of a brain disease. I gotta put this in, it's so beautiful. Described by my doctor as, it's kind of like bats hanging from the back of your brain stem upside down and slowly eating their way up.
Lovely.
That hit with a smashing series of headaches and high temperatures, and I got rushed to the hospital. So the pastor telling my parents that I had AIDS went to Mark.
How difficult was it for you to tell your friends and your family? What's the reaction that you get?
For a long time, I didn't tell anybody. I didn't want to tell anybody because AIDS is such a horrible thing in people's minds. So everybody's a death sentence. So when you tell somebody that you have AIDS, they start treating you that way. Like you're a sick person or a leper or somebody's going to die soon. And it's not a comfortable way to live. I mean, it may be true that, you know, I could die in 6 months or 2 years or 5 years or whatever, but you can't live like that. And to have people looking at you that way all the time is really uncomfortable. You really feel crappy. So I didn't, God, I think John started telling people that I had AIDS. And then when he gets sick, because I've had the AIDS for almost 2 years. And when he got sick this past summer, he ended up slowly telling people because he had to, and then it could reveal that I had AIDS.
And this and the rolling.
It is rolling.
Yeah.
Well, it works, huh?
Yeah.
This is slightly because you should be looking at the camera, but if you look at the camera, then you can't see yourself on the monitor.
Well, let's look forward into the void instead.
How's that for a dramatic effect?
What a composition. Watch this. This is really gonna...
You're supposed to imagine this is some kind of plant blowing in the breeze.
It actually looks like an amoeba for me, sort of.
Well, that's because you're probably more primordial than I am.
Yeah.
So you can see like this. Radiation burns.
Yeah. One thing I've noticed on this here is where are you? You're down here someplace. Is your eye, where you hit that red line on your eyelid there.
Oh, that's over here.
No, there's one on this side.
There is?
Yeah.
What are you saying? There is one now, there isn't one?
There
now?
Is one.
Where?
Right there? A little line, yeah.
That's new?
I don't know. I've never seen it before, but I haven't looked at your eyes in a long time.
I haven't either. I haven't seen it.
Maybe you'll get to have the...
Oh, God, thanks. A little lead shield stuck in my eyelid.
Yeah.
Sure feels like it.
Well, Silver Lake Live normally takes place in Silver Lake, California. But in the end, it goes where I go. And it's Christmas time. And this summer, when I almost died and my family came out and saw me, one of the things that we talked about, the way to keep me going, and a goal to set and live towards, was Christmas, when I fly back and say hello to them all. So, mid-December, Mark and I hopped in an airplane, ready to go back the cold winter to share Christmas with my family. There seemed to be some tension about this trip to New Hampshire. I was already sick, I was worried about the cold, and I think they were also worried that I had started to make this tape again. Because literally 15 years ago, I'd made a movie about being gay and growing up gay. And it was asking a lot of them at the time. And this is some of that material.
one day in this very spot. This is less than 300 yards from my house. I'd bicycle down here, you know, this is around 14 or 15. And I came across, I think it's right by this tree, yeah, a rock, and under the rock was a note. And it was right under here, and there were notes in it, you know. And the notes were between two gay lovers, and they were communicating when they were going to meet. So I wrote back to them. That's scared shitless, of course. But I wrote back to them, telling them about it, and then came back, and they left me a dirty magazine. And being gay, every mother finds dirty magazines that their kids collected, you know, that they hide under the mattress, but not dirty male magazines, you know. And you develop this whole inner secretiveness where you learn not to tell people, you know, and to hide things and to cover things up, and it begins to change your personality. And you learn how to socialize with women and pretend to follow the whole route that all your peers are following, when in the end it's kind of all a lie. And you learn to lie pretty well. And I'm tired of lying. I don't want to lie anymore. So I make this film, right?
My name is Mark Massey, and I'm your lover. Back in college, you had decided that you couldn't love anybody, and you didn't want to love anybody, and you were going to love everybody through film by doing great, tender, romantic films. And I madly fell in love with you because I was desperately in need to love somebody, and our minds just seemed to work together. We understood life kind of on the same level. And it took almost a year of me yelling and screaming and pulling my hair out and getting very suicidal before you finally fell in love with me.
Relationship to me?
My name is Mary Jocelyn, middle name Kimball, and I am your mother.
Okay. Are you nervous?
Not very, no.
I am.
You are?
Yeah.
Can you remember clearly the first time that I ever told you that I was homosexual?
Yes, indeed.
Could you relate that?
Yes, it was in the lobby of the New England Center at the University of New Hampshire. And I was standing at the time on an orange rug, and I very shortly sat down.
I don't even like to think about it. I think it's awful. And I think we must have done something wrong to get that way. And I don't think you ought to advertise it. I don't think in this movie you ought to even mention it. He said it would be maybe not embarrassing to you, but it would be embarrassing as hell to me.
Family life has always meant so much. And to think that you would not have a family of your own was a great disappointment to me.
What about Mark? How did you get along with Mark?
I don't know how frank I should be about this, Tom.
Well, I don't know. Mark is seems to be a nice guy. There's two or three things against him that, as far as I'm concerned. First is luck. He looks like he's on a fall over, and he looks like he got TV to me. I don't know. And, of course, he's got two strikes against him anyway, having something to do with your married life, shall we say. It doesn't seem quite normal to us, to the normal people. So naturally, he's got three strikes against him. On the other hand, he's always very nice and pleasant, to me anyway. But I don't think I ought to say any more. But in other words, he isn't the type of guy I would pick out for a friend.
Yeah.
You understand? He and I couldn't get along, I'm sure. Because he'd be, we think in different circles, different ways, and so on.
We just don't think alike. We don't live alike. I think he resents a great deal about me, and I resent something about him.
She's a typical liberal, you know. On the surface, she's nice and kind to us, you know, and says, oh, okay, I realize that you are... I mean, she doesn't know what gay is, okay? She says we're homosexual, and she accepts the fact that we're homosexuals, and she feels sort of sorry for us in her own little way that, you know, we can't live like the rest of the world. And those sort of things just, I mean, when you build them up on a larger scale, that's what makes homosexuals commit suicide.
As we begin to see who we are, we've got to see that little seemingly unimportant details, such as words and labels, tell a story. A fairy tale of sorts. So let me say a little about gay as opposed to homosexual. They are opposites, and not just two words expressing similar objects, because only one talks about objects. In order to understand these words, we must understand that this society is a multicultured one, but in reality it recognizes only one culture. The others are under genocidal attack. So now for us, it is a beautiful thing to be blatant, where at one time it was looked down upon. We have come to see that it is the fairies, faggots, queens, etc., that were, through their blatantness, the first to challenge the system. In essence, saying they had the right to be super gay, because blatant is beautiful. So we also know that it will not be until what straights call blatant behavior is accepted with respect that we are, in any sense, any of us, free. The personal is the political, the economic, and the cultural. Gay is the revolution.
You love me?
Oh, yes.
When that showed on PBS, there was a little consternation, I can tell you. So maybe some fear that I was redoing a new tape also added to the pressure. But I arrived, and there was an entourage to meet Mark and me. Friendly people from the family. This is Momare, ever beautiful. And back at home, this is Sam, about to take a treat at the table. From my father. Don't feed the dog at the table.
It goes down fast, doesn't it?
It sure does.
Well.
Oh, hi there. I'm Whitey Jocelyn. I'm Tom's older brother.
Hey, yes, it is me, Whitey Jocelyn. It is I, excuse me, Whitey Jocelyn, the star of the previous Tommy Jocelyn Spectacular. My wife, Susan.
What happened right away when you found out that I had it?
You're saying when we found out you had AIDS?
Yeah.
It wasn't that we didn't expect to hear it because you had told us that Mark had AIDS. And he did not.
And we started talking about you being sick, and your dad said about his brother Bob, who had died a few years earlier of cancer. So you'd gone to see him once, and could only stay in the room for 5 minutes because it was just too painful for him.
Dad never went back, apparently, after the first time he went to visit him, and said he didn't want to see him, remember him that way, I guess.
At that point, the phone rang, and it was you. And you said to your mom, and I'll never forget these exact words, Mom, I just wanted to ask you, do you understand AIDS? Do you understand what's happening? And she said, yes. And he said, do you understand? I sort of sensed like you were saying, I'd kind of like you guys to come out here. And I said it, I think, quite bluntly, you guys should go. And then, we'll think about it, I don't know. And you turned around and said to him, didn't you listen to that phone call? Tommy wants you out there. What's he got to do? It's just, I guess I find it hard that your mom and dad just sort of are dealing with it it doesn't exist.
I'm going to
out with a present.
Oh, we got open presents today?
You gonna get Tom?
The idea was about to make you spend a vortex.
Okay, so I went back out after I got the list.
Oh, you did? Ooh, isn't that pretty?
Oh,
great shoulders.
Well, here we are. Back in the hospital. In the emergency room, in the middle of New Hampshire, I'm 4 days away from going home, January 1st. They always say whatever you're doing on the first day of the year is what you do for the rest of your life. Well, here we are.
Phenylpropanolamine is a decongestant, and it works pretty well as a decongestant, but it does a whole bunch of other odd things, including sleep disturbances and palpitations and urinary urgency. And the first thing we should do is to undo, and that is to not take the Biotus, to not take Cephalexin. I want to give you some naproxen.
Well, by the time we'd finished in New Hampshire this year for Christmas, I was sick, exhausted, unhappy with my family, and never so glad to get away and come back to the lights of Hollywood.
You haven't had any of this cold, excuse
me. No, but could you check to make sure that there's nothing up here for me?
Okay.
What was it?
I found the viral infection. The blood stagnation seems to be pretty well cleared up.
Thank you. Well, I didn't want to walk this case.
Good. Yeah, fungus in the hospital's good too.
Okay. Yes.
Yeah.
What's going to happen?
I don't know. I think it's pretty much the same, but I can't help
probably. There's a lot more of that brownish.
There is more yellow.
Yeah. You haven't noticed any new lesions?
No.
Well, miracle of miracles, we're going to use the same formula 2 weeks in a row.
No. Hey, guys, what's wrong? Come on.
That's okay.
Party.
Okay.
We went to Dr. Matt. Went through our usual thing this morning. The sandwich was fine, and I got too tired to film towards the end and went and slept in the car while Mark had lunch. I didn't have lunch because we were going to go right home. I remember he said we were going to go right home and you can have soup and then I go shopping. I remember that. So he brought me some soup anyway because the soup is so good. So what happens next? Next he run away home and I say, okay, I get enough energy. Go ahead, do the food shopping at APLA. It's right between here and home. It's an easy stop. And I'll go to the bank and get my glasses. So he does that and I do that. And then we're on the way home and he says, look, we're almost done. I'm going to go to the health food store, which is not on the way home. And it is now 3:30. So we go to the health food store and I sit in the car and try to sleep and can't. So then he comes back and says, look, it's only one more stop. I'm going to go to the Mayfair to get tonight's dinner so I don't have to go out again. We've got to protect my health. Well, I haven't had fucking dinner. I haven't had any... Jesus! I try to be helpful getting screwed time and time again. I hate being a nice guy. Well, of course, it wasn't really Mark's fault. It's just anger at my incapacity to do the normal things that I used to be able to do, and it gets me so angry.
There. Voila! Chaos medicine.
You were telling me something a minute ago that I wanted to hear and put on tape.
About loving you?
Yes. That's all.
Oh, yes, no, I do. I love you. I said, you asked me how much or something?
Yeah, I just do you love
me. I said, it hurts. But I can't stand feeling sick. It drives me crazy. I can't do anything about it. I can't control it. I don't know what it means. And it makes you unhappy and it makes me unhappy. And it drives me nuts. Sometimes makes me very angry. Those are the times I thought I can't do anything about it.
Mm.
And other times it hurts because I can't do anything for you. And then sometimes it scares me.
Now there's a good night kiss, huh? I bet you people don't get those.
That's another bad thing. Sleep for about half an hour, and then I wake up and think I just sleep for another 2 hours based on my head banging. And then while I'm awake, I just of all these things. In this case, it's about the auto show. I'm supposed to go to the auto show tomorrow. It will be the first thing I've done all week that isn't a doctor's visit. But I don't think I have the energy to go. I've already canceled a couple of visitations. And I started taking a wheelchair, but I'm neither ready to admit that I want a wheelchair yet or to go through the hassle of that. Plus, it's raining out, so that will make that even worse. And maybe I just shouldn't go, but if I don't, I'm admitting that I'm doomed to lying here in this bed for the rest of my life, and that's an unpleasant reality. So, I don't know. Well, although the real issue wasn't the auto show or not the auto show, and it was just about tossing and turning at night, you'd be happy to know that we decided not to go to the auto show. And now we're going to go to the record store instead.
Superman Stronium 90 rod here. This is what you weren't supposed to drink in the 1950s in milk. Dr. Melby also gave me a couple of names of people to check out about treatments for KS.
Uh-huh.
I heard a couple of cases of successful treatment of people that had a number of KS being really clear. And it's one of the problems, of course, is the expense of it.
Okay.
Are we on the third time to the alphabet or the fourth time?
We're on the third time.
I'm ready for my close-up, Mr. DeMille.
There we go.
Before we get into the session, you said that both of you were not quite up to par or less than or whatever, you know, maybe we, I wonder if maybe it might be helpful to talk about what has been happening or how both of you are right now.
Well, I've really been sick since New Hampshire. Fevers running an average of 101 and stuff like that, and we went to Dr. Matt and got a tea mixture and stuff that demanded every half hour, which is a discipline that I'm not up to. And then Mark was the alarm clock and would bring the tea in, you know. And then I would
fall asleep and miss a bell.
Oh, you don't miss a bell. No, you're making it sound like you miss, well, I've just missed one or two today, and you don't. If you're left on your own, you take, like, you know, half or less of what you're supposed to take. To me, there's a problem there. If you're supposed to take it every half hour, and you kind of forget and only take it two or three times a day, that's more than forgetting. To me, there's something else wrong there. But for me to, like, say, okay, I can't do this anymore, you do it. In another situation, I could do that. But the fact that we both have AIDS, I have the added fear that, well, if he dies, of course, I don't want him to do that. That's the major thing. I don't want him to die. But the other thing is, that leaves me alone with AIDS, to die by myself with AIDS.
Can you explain to him, Tom?
No. I can't. I mean, part of me says, well, I do take my medicine. And then it's true that I don't take all my medicine.
I guess one of the things that affects me a lot is I probably am a doomsday ager, you know, in the sense of statistically and everything else. It seems to have its arc, if you will, and I'm pretty far down the arc, and I know that there's always exceptions, but I do feel, you know, the wall is not that far away. And there's a certain amount of desperation in relation to this kind of thing, the videotaping, as compared to just the other parts of life. So,
the difference between the two of you in this issue that I see is that given the same threat, your way of fighting that threat is different, quite different. You, Mark, you're trying to lower the threat. You, Tom, you're trying to make the most out of what you have.
Well, this is my bedroom. There's this shelf here with flowers, food, and tapes to the editors. The camera I do my diary with is Mark.
Here I am, Helga, with the laundry. I have just done all of our little delicates, our little undies, our things.
Thank you, Helga. This is the camera that I do my diary work with. And then 1, 2, 3 cups of medicine that I drink. Then there's the tape deck. And here's the monitor, which is on a armature device. It's going to be raised and lowered and pulled out and pushed away. It was all designed with the idea that I'd end up sick in bed all the time, and yet still be able to make my movie.
This whole tequila, so make it a good one.
Thank you.
tired. I've been doing this all day long.
Oh, that's terrible.
Yeah, but you've got a long way to go. You think you'll make it all the way?
It's going so fast. It's wonderful.
Really?
The people and the entertainment make it go so fast.
Yeah, great.
Yeah, I'll make it all the way.
Have a good time.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Well, let's see. I've been very sick for 2.5 weeks, lying in bed mostly, all the time. I just seem to, the last couple days, be regaining strength. You're only going to see me on my good sides. During that time, I got extremely depressed. Would have been happy to have just died. The phrase that I came up with is, that I have lost the steam of life. The steam of life. The thing that powers you, keeps you rolling towards something. I know the lesson is that you're just supposed to learn to roll, and not roll towards something. Like a rolling stone, you know? It's old wisdom, and it is wise, but I feel so empty, and I feel so pointless, and I have so much trouble remembering anything good I've done. As if that brings value to my life, I don't know, you see. Of course it doesn't bring value to my life. And I know the real story is that you get what you get. You live a happy life, you've had a happy life. You live a tormented life, and you're always worrying and naysaying. That's the life you will have lived.
Deciding if we're going to sit in it or continue to the next chair in a brave effort of physical dynamism. We pass the chair in a brave effort of physical dynamism. And I love you, Mark, so much.
Right here.
Nobody here. We're going.
The woman who invited us here, who owns the place, is very nice. She was very nice to us, and she would like me to keep my shirt on so I don't freak out any of the people. And I do that, but it also then feeds into that bad part of me that I don't, you know, being self-conscious and disliking my body and whatnot. And mostly I worry about those things because I don't want to upset other people with having to look at ugly me. So it ends up feeding into a bad part of me, or I should just normally be proud of it, because normally I'm proud that I've been alive this long. And I'm just like, screw you, I'm living, you know, I'm not dead.
Back into the cubbyhole.
What?
What are you doing, flashing me at your KS?
Yeah. I was being political.
What is this that passes before my eyes every day? I spend most of my time looking, seeing, just watching this strange thing pass in front of me. I'm not much of a participant in life anymore. I'm a distant viewer. Just watching it all pass by, knowing that I'm not going to have that much longer to keep my eye on the prize. Hear that industrial sound in the background? Those big dumpsters being pulled up. Someone rebuilding their house. More trash going to some dump that doesn't have room for it on a freeway that's full of cars. The civilization is so strange. I've never felt much a part of it. I think being gay separates you a little. Certainly having AIDS and being a walking dead, if you will, separates one from the everyday world. It's a beautiful day in the neighborhood. It really is a beautiful day, by the way. Wonderful sun, not too hot, not too cold, little breeze.
I don't know what anybody could ask for more.
Dr. Jenkins in the office the other day during our monthly visit says, well, it's kind of time, Tom. And then he looks at me and says, you know, you should maybe start looking for a hospice. The corollary of all of that information, of course, being that, you know, average lifespan in a hospice is about 2 months. Time, that kind of stuff, which was very startling to hear. I think I was that sick, even though sometimes I sort of wanted to be. And it was greeted with very weak feelings, a real bombshell. And that's about it. That story.
Well, what have you been doing since then?
About the same as I was doing before. Leaving a lot. Rolling over, receiving some more. That kind of thing. Taking my medicine.
Tell me about all the people coming to visit and what you feel about it.
Well, that's been hard. Been having a lot of guests and we have a lot more coming. It seems like they're coming to say hi before we die, you know, that kind of let's say hi to Mark and Tom in case things are gonna get bad real quick.
Yep. Well, what do you feel of Sue's visit now that it's all over?
It was a nice visit, kind of innocuous. It ended very quietly. The last day and a half she almost stayed away from me because I was sleeping a lot. So I didn't get to see her much, which was okay in terms of what I wanted to have happen. She knew when to stay away, you know. So I had no trouble. You apparently had more trouble than I did.
Yeah, you took the camera.
What do you think of Susan?
Well, I let you get me in frame.
Okay.
Well, it's funny. You probably slept through most of Sue's visit, but Sue's visit was very helpful, very good. She helped a lot. I learned a lot. She got me through a lot of bad times. But it was a whole situation where Sue was into Tom is dying of AIDS. And the reason she stayed away from you those last 2 days is because you were going through a quote-unquote a period of acceptance and withdrawal and needed to be left alone so that she could get ready to die. Not that she was just leaving you alone because you were sleeping. It was very taxing in that way, in that it was like a barrage of death notices, which I don't think was positive for me in the end, in that vein.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Good morning, Tom. As I said earlier, this is June 1st. How are you today?
The vital beginning. You started on my urine bottle?
No, I started on your empty breakfast plate.
Oh, very good. Thank you.
You made it another month. We made it another month.
Yeah. May, April, March. What is it?
June 1st here.
June 1st. My mind's been getting vague lately, which is sort of a problem carrying on a nice conversation. Happened in the car the other day. And
with who?
I don't know. Who was I in the car with the other day? Anybody?
One car you've ever been with me was the doctor's on Tuesday.
Someone must have driven me to county.
No, you've never been to county, Tom.
Anyway.
here we are, having our fabulous European ocean cruise. Mr. Jocelyn is out here on the deck with his sunglasses, his walking stick, his little cap to keep the sun off the top of his head, and his chocolate shake.
Welcome, welcome. I hope you're enjoying your trip.
And this is where we're going. Somewhere in the Mediterranean.
So we'll track further inputs on our journey. Shorter than we thought it was going to be. But then, at flight.
This is Judy. Judy Lynn's visiting.
Am I in focus?
Yes, you're in focus here. Could you go into the living room and get the photograph of Tom and me?
In the frame?
Yeah, the one in the frame.
Judy is a photographer. And this particular photo shoot she's going to show us is the one that she made for us. For us.
A year and a half ago on our anniversary.
It's really good.
You might be thinking of some glare or something. I'll give you one
more guy. There we are. There's Tom and me and Tom in the picture a year and a half ago. We're obviously right after you had a great haircut. Remember who else is coming next week?
Next week? No, I don't.
You know what I should do? I should make a big chart on the wall with a calendar of everybody who's coming.
Well, Lane is coming.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Bo is coming next, probably Thursday or Friday, after his compound Q. And then Elaine is coming this next weekend. And then next Thursday, your mother and Betsy are coming. And if Whitey can get a plane while he's flying out to San Francisco, he'll come up for a day. And then Sharon and Maddie are supposed to be coming that same weekend. And then after that, Bill Vincent.
What does Whitey do?
He's the brother.
What does he do?
Airport.
Oh. You should give him a plane.
There is that right there.
You should give you a plane.
Exactly.
You should give me a plane.
Well, there you have it.
Let's write him a letter.
You love me?
Yes, I love you.
Do you like me videotaping you?
Yes.
I like videotaping you too a lot.
Mark's making Tom's breakfast. Let's see, what do we have here?
No, well, this is, I'm not going to give them now. This is a little thick. This is raspberry cream cheese.
Miso soup. Cheesecake. The egg. Stirring.
Mash it up to make it easily edible. Well. The thing. Should have warned you, I'm sorry. Today's Monday, and I think that's June 19th. I'm not absolutely sure. I could check later. Tom?
Huh?
You want to wait?
Huh?
There we go. Okay. I love you. You look like Queen Elizabeth. Okay, thank you.
This is a letter that Tom wrote his mother. It says, I love you, and I'm going to mail it to her for him today. Our landlord, Mike, just got his doctor's reports back on Friday. And today he told me he wants to go up and see our herb doctor, which means Mike's test came back positive. And Bob, Ron's lover, he's positive, so he's going back to our herb doctor, too. Cleaned Tom's fingernails today. I soaked them and cut them and cleaned underneath them. Okay, you two, tell me what you thought of Tom, how he looked and how he was. And
I don't think I had seen Tom for about 3 weeks, 2 or 3 weeks, or had talked to him, and I was surprised how quickly he'd gone downhill.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You haven't seen him the last time.
Probably. He was skinnier than I've ever seen him, and I don't know.
This came in the mail yesterday, and this is Tom's Medi-Cal benefits have to be reestablished, because I guess it's been a year or something, I don't know. And they give you a cover sheet with what kind of information they want, and they check it off. First, they want the statement of facts for Medi-Cal, which is this. All these pages, both sides, they want work history, they want everything, property, what he owns, what's in the bank, second parent or other spouse income. This is the exact same stupid form that you had to fill out to apply for Medi-Cal. Also, down here they want his current income verification, as if they already don't know that he has AIDS and he's on SSI and SSD. They know that already. Plus, they want receipts for child care costs. Now, why check that off? They know he doesn't have any children if they look at the thing. And then his banking, savings, and checking information. They've got all this information. You can't fill this out anyway.
Did you sleep well last night?
How good.
Elaine said she's going to take the camera to the Huntington Garden today. Is that okay?
How are we doing?
I don't know. Did you get what?
Is that what we're doing?
That's what we're doing. Do you want me to stay home with you?
Well, let's hope to...
Ian's going to be here, the housekeeper.
Sue said, Sue told us at the Huntington Gardens were beautiful. Well worth seeing.
Yeah.
She said she should go there if she can.
Lying in bed here, all nice and cool. I'll show you, see, he even has his pants undone here, so that he can be cool. And I haven't done any video recording for the last couple of days, because I felt really bad. And I gave some Tom some food that didn't settle well, and it made him throw up all night. And it made him a little sicker and a little weaker. And I was just ashamed I had done that. And I was afraid to turn on the camera. Because everybody would see that he was weaker again. But I just love him so much.
This is Tom's right eyelid. It has a KS lesion on it. You can see that on the upper rim, it's very dark. And that hurts him a great deal. See, I can pull the eye open, and you can see down his eye inside. But the top lid, up here, he says it hurts him now. But his other eye over here, that eye's fine. That eye you can see in the camera with. Okay, tell the camera how you feel. He says he feels pretty bad.
I haven't felt chipper.
Doesn't feel chipper.
I don't feel good.
Doesn't feel good.
Hello? This is the 1st of July, and Tommy's just died. My little Willie died, and I sang to him, you are my sunshine, my only sunshine. You make me happy when skies are gray. You'll never know, dear, how much I love you. Please don't take my sunshine away. Isn't he beautiful? He's so beautiful. This is for you, Tommy. All of us, all your friends will finish the tape for you, okay? We promise. We promise. Bye. Bye, Tom.
Any rings, any jewelry on anything?
No, he does. Oh, I think he lost that ring. I get his hands crossed.
Yeah.
Fell off.
Yeah, okay. On him here, or?
No. Oh, no, long time ago.
Oh, okay. I need to get a little information, so.
Okay. There you go. I'm going to cover you up again, Tom. All right. There we go.
Well, you know his name and his birthday.
Yeah,
we know that.
Sure.
I sure don't want to displace you.
Well,
slow her down.
What is Thomas's
birthday to you?
November 29th, 1946.
November 29th, 1946.
You know that better than I do.
And what state was he born in?
Massachusetts.
Do you happen to know the social security number offhand? If not, we'll get it later.
I don't know.
Okay. So we're going to use you then as the next of kin. It's Mark.
Right, M-A-R-K. M-A-S-S-I.
This is the same address, right?
Yeah. I got this book in the mail today. It's called How to Survive the Loss of a Love. It came from my counselor at APLA. I've been laughing a lot at the book today. I'm in the anger phase, and this book tells you all about the different phases you go through. And on the left-hand column, they have just plain old practical information. And on this page, the other page, the opposing page, they have little poetries, little pieces of poems to tell you what they're about. And there's titles like What Loss Feels Like, as if I don't know. Then they go through the stages of recovery. The first is shock and denial. One of the little poems I liked very much here was, I know it was time for us to part, but today, I know I had much pain to go through, but tonight, which was kind of true. It's kind of like I understood all this was going to happen, but it always happened so fast. They also have charts here on the healing process. This is not how we recover. This one here, which they call like a lightning bolt with dramatic leaps and depressing backslides. This is how we truly recover. You can expect to be in shock for a while. This emotional numbness may be frightening. You may struggle both to believe and to disbelieve that this could have happened to you. I like that one. Because you do. You struggle to believe it, like I can't believe it happened. And then once you do believe that it happened, you don't want to believe that it happened. It has happened. It is real. Recognize that a loss has taken place. You are strong enough. You will survive. But that's it. That's all now. This is my self-help book. Will definitely get me through this depression.
And how long, what day is this?
This is day two. Day two after Tom died. And I actually, there was a big dramatic change this morning. All the pain and tension in my gut and the feeling that I can't do anything, that I'm trapped and I'm going to throw up and whatnot or implode, that's gone. And it is replaced with, as I said, anger, which is much more comical and cynical to deal with. Thank you. bleeding.
We should know that from the very beginning, God gave all of his creation freedom. God gave freedom for viruses to exist, and one of those viruses causes AIDS. It doesn't mean that God sends AIDS or any other sickness. Bad things do happen to good people. Jesus loves people with AIDS. Jesus loves any sick person. Jesus loves well people. Jesus loves gay people. Jesus loves straight people. Let us never forget that on that cross, Jesus shed his precious blood for all of humanity. He didn't have a list of who was worthy and who was not. That salvation was a gift given to all humanity and for all time.
These two characters really shaped my life a lot. They brought me in. They shared life with me very patiently. They showed me New York. They showed me their relationship. They showed me art and the price of being grown-ups. And now they have shown me even more about illness and loss, giving up, enduring, and about the boundaries of love. And then my thoughts turned to other friends I had lost. How many was it now? It seemed I should be keeping count of these things. My thoughts then flashed back to the years of the 60s, in a time when we sat before the television set and were given body counts from Vietnam, 250 enemy dead, 35 Americans dead. It seemed that we as a society want to assign importance to a situation by keeping score. The 35 American dead were less important somehow because the score was 250 to 35 in our favor. And so now the count marches on in this battle. But we are faced with a dilemma in our war with AIDS. There are no enemy dead to count this time. We are faced with the prospect of counting only the dead among our loved ones.
My brother had a dream, and he had the guts to dare to be different, to follow his dream. My brother Tom left us a legacy. He bequeathed to us his unfulfilled dream, Silver Lake life, the view from here. When I last saw Tom, Mark and I spoke of destiny. Perhaps it was Tom's destiny to die in order to create the full impact of Silver Lake life.
Well, before Silver Lake Life could have any impact, it had to be completed. When Tom died, I was in France. But 5 months later, I went back to California to film an ending and to visit Mark. We talked about everything that had happened since the last time I saw them.
What about Tom's parents? What happened between you and his family when he died?
Family. He wants to talk about family. Well, there was a big issue with Tom anyways. Way back when he first got sick with cryptococcus meningitis. Was whether his family was going to come out here to see him. And they didn't know if it would do any good. And, you know, should they come out now, should they come out later, all these kind of things. And then when he got really sick this last time, there was a question about who should come out again, you know, was it time? One of the things which I haven't even mentioned in any of the tapes so far is Charlie's wonderful line of, well, would it do any good if he came out? And I kept trying to tell Charlie that good didn't make any difference. Do you want to see your son one last time before he dies? You know. But anyway, so when Tom died and we're all crying, Charlie comes running into the room. And the first thing he tries to do is get Mary to leave the room, saying, it's all over now. Come on out here. Don't do this to yourself. And I finally had to yell at him and say, you know, leave her alone, let her stay, this is the last she's going to be with her son. But that whole experience between Mary and I and Tom dying and taking care of him did change her opinion of me even more. I've been adopted as pretty much a son to her. We both went through something together that only she and I went through. Nobody else did this but she and I. So this experience has really brought us together and made us really close.
Seems like there's more than a little bit of irony in the situation.
Oh, yes, sir. The fact that Tom had to die for her to see how much I really did love him.
What about your father?
We've never gotten along very well. But when Tom died, I sent him a letter and told him about it, and I was surprised. He wrote me a letter back, and this is it. This is the only letter I have ever gotten from my father. Hi, Mark. I have never written you, but I am now. I know you have a problem, but take it one day at a time. I had to make the best of it. I had the two of you to take care of. I did tell both of you, if you are gay, just don't tell the world. Heck, I told you of gays after me, and you said I might like it. Well, I had a gay come to my apartment. Wow. Well, anyway, keep up the faith. It will all work out. Your dad. It was a very weird letter. This is surreal letter. That I think that letter does recognize, in that letter, my father does recognize that Tom and I were a couple, a family. Because he talks about it in terms of him losing his wife, my mother.
How long did you and Tom live together?
Almost 22 years. It'll be 22 years, January 11th.
Tell me about life now.
Life now? Life now is very confusing. I mean, it's even hard to organize thoughts when I have to talk about it. Because I'm in horrendous physical pain all the time because of my rectal problems. I'm on lots of painkillers, which make me weird. I have my own AIDS, my own falling T-cell count. I'm just really beat. By the easiest way to put it, I'm really, really beat.
Along with the gas, still is that inability to digest, you know, food, so I'm still not really eating two meals a day at the most, and that means it went still. And it also means I haven't been the last couple of days, I haven't been able to take all my medicines at night. Because they just won't digest. Does it look like it's still getting lighter?
Yeah, it's the same thing. The center of the lesions are all blanched out.
Yeah.
are still yellow around the edges.
They're still very yellow around the edges. More so, I would say, than last week. You think they're yellow?
Yes, this is a lot yellow. Very more blanched out than they used to be. But you know, we're still not out of the problem, but the newer ones are still growing. It's still pretty good. Part of me just has never believed that there was anything else. Until Tom came back. All of a sudden, zoom from, Tom always comes from up here somewhere, zoom down, he was like standing behind the chair and kind of like leaning into me and with his head like kind of resting on my shoulder with his head up against the side of my head. And he just stayed there for the longest time. And it really is a strange energy that comes from up high, that comes zipping around, and it's not really attached to the world we live in. One conversation I had with him, I was telling him that, you know, it was really nice to have him around because it was really hard to live day to day without him. But then I said, well, but if you've got to, you know, if it's your time to go and you've got to go dissipate into the universe and become one with it all, you know, don't hang around here for me. I said, I'll survive. And I get this very clear message that said, you idiot, I've got nothing else to do now. You know, so he doesn't have anything else to do. He's free. He can do what he wants to do. So he's come and visited me probably about 3 or 4 times now.
Why do you think he's only come 3 or 4 times? Why doesn't he just hang around all the time?
I mean, he's never given any indication. I can only guess. So I think it would probably be bad for me. I couldn't get on with my life. Which is hard enough to get on with anyways. And he's gone. I mean, he's dead. So I think he is somewhere else. It's like, you know, I can't go there. He can't come here that often or something. I don't know. But I think mostly it's because he's dead. And he knows he is. And he's not, like, stuck here.
Well, I met him on a Sunday, ooh, and I miss him on Monday, ooh. Well, I found him on Tuesday, ooh.
On her deathbed and then Gertrude. What's the answer?
And what did Gertrude reply?
What's the question?
Goodbye.
I don't need you anymore. I wake my pillow every night, but now I show the light. Goodbye, goodbye, Adam. I don't need you anymore. Goodbye.
That not to diminish the harshness with which it confronts the problems of people with AIDS and the realities of the daily life of people living with AIDS. But there's another part of the story which is also a part of the story of many people with AIDS, which is that they are in committed relationships where two lovers are caring for each other, and when in many cases both of them are sick, which was the case with Mark and Tom. I think AIDS has forced us as gay people into the public spotlight, it's the intention of Silver Lake Life to show not only what the miseries and suffering that people with AIDS go through, but also the love that exists between gay couples as they care for each other in these life or death situations. The first time I went to visit Mark after Tom died, I wasn't in the door 2 seconds before he thrust at me a Polaroid of Tom that he had taken after Tom had died and said, "Here, you want to see Tom dead?" And it's important to remember in this story that this was the person he loved most in the world, and Mark was only 6 months away from his own death at the time he did that. And that was his way of announcing to me, this is what happened, and we are not going to pretend it hasn't happened. We are going to deal with it. And that was Mark and Tom's approach to AIDS, and it was their approach to life. But this culture is not very good about dealing with death. It's something that always happens out of sight. People disappear slowly, or you hear statistics, or you hear that someone died. And yet it's a very common experience. This culture is also not very good at dealing with homosexuality, and in AIDS is an area where these things have unfortunately coincided, so we have a kind of double denial on the part of the culture about what's going on. So it was Mark and Tom's desire to create out of their personal crisis an image which was designed to let the world know really what was going on. I had very little guidelines about what I should do with the tapes. I knew basically what Tom's style was, but I had 40 hours of material, which was sort of documents of daily life and old films of Tom's and things like that. And so I really had to find a way to tell the story myself. There were many things that Tom wanted to do in Silver Lake Life that he just never got to shoot. And my style as an editor was very different from his. So Silver Lake Life is a very different film than it would have been had Tom lived to complete it. But the fact that it isn't is representative of his absence, and that absence is really part of what the film is about.